Yeah. Good morning, everybody. This will be a series of cases highlighting an important aspect of clinical presentations of cytomegalovirus uveitis in an individual. So this is a young male who came, 32-year-old male, who came with colored halos and sudden drop in vision. And we saw just a few cells and a few KPs. So this was a typical Posner-Schlossman syndrome. And the intraocular pressures were very high. This is another case who presented with Fuchs heterochromic iridocyclitis. Please note the iris pattern difference. The most interesting thing, one is acute and the other is chronic. But if you see the intraocular pressures, it was very high, 40 to 60. And this is one of the presentations of cytomegalovirus, anterior uveitis. And the investigation which we do in such cases is an AC tap, and we look specifically for cytomegalovirus. And the practical tip will be the yield is high when the tap is done at the time of increase in intraocular pressures. There are certain characteristic findings which we should not miss, and that is this owl-like appearance, which is actually an infected endothelial cell. And sometimes you can see the immune ring or the corneal endothelitis in patients with CMV anterior uveitis. They're usually seen in immunocompetent individuals, and the treatment is by topical steroids. Antivirals are needed as a maintenance for a little longer period of time, along with anti-glaucoma medications. To go into the posterior segment, these are the different manifestations of what we call a cytomegalovirus retinitis. And the clinical feature is very characteristic, where you have a granular appearance, which is mixed with retinal hemorrhages. And it usually follows the pattern of, or follows along the blood vessel. Sometimes you can also see this kind of retinal vasculitis, which is what we call as the frosted branch angiitis. And you can see a pale disc, a very granular appearance, and sometimes you can see a patch with the frosted branch angiitis. So these are the typical appearances which we describe in cytomegalovirus retinitis, what we call as the pizza pie, the tomato ketchup, brush fire, and the frosted branch angiitis. And the most important thing what we need to do when we see a pattern like this is look for immune suppression. So what we normally do is check for ELISA, which is the most common type of immune suppression which we see. And we also do a CD4, CD8, and a CD4, CD8 ratios. In patients with immunosuppression in the form of if they are on, if they have transplants and they are on immunosuppressives, it's always better to look in the blood for the CMV load, because that will also decide whether these patients need to be on systemic ganciclovir for a long period of time. And the most important investigation from the ocular fluids will be the PCR. And this is done to rule out cytomegalovirus. And we also do a ganciclovir resistance on, by sequencing. And you look for the UL97 and UL54 genes. So this is a 48-year-old lady. Again, the pattern is very typical along the blood vessel and retinitis. And we checked for HIV. She was HIV positive, and this was a 56-year-old lady. Her CD4 counts were very low. It was 16. Now, unfortunately, she could not afford intravenous ganciclovir at that point of time, so we started her on intravitreal injections. And the most important thing is these people should be started on heart almost immediately after one or two injections. And we start seeing the resolution of retinitis, but just a close look, you start seeing these kind of arthritis along the arteries. So when you see a sign like this, it is always better to start these patients on systemic therapy as well. So this is, again, if you see what we call as a chiralis arteriolus, and she had to take intravenous ganciclovir, because these are the cases which progress to ischemia and neovascularization, and they will also require early laser photocoagulation. So one of an important indication for systemic is when you see arthritis, it's always better to start these patients on systemic therapy. This is one of our older patients where had severe whitening of the vessels, and in the left eye she had this bilateral arthritis, and he required a maintenance dose of valganciclovir for nearly 6 months. And one eye progressed very fast within 2 months to neovascular glaucoma, so the other eye was lasered almost immediately. Now we are seeing more of this pattern, which is the immune recovery uveitis, where you have the retinitis and severe granulomatous uveitis. Sometimes it can be simple as that, or it can be very exuberant like this. So this patient had a sudden surge of CD4 counts to 128, and these are patients which need to be started on oral steroids as well in conjunction with an infectious disease specialist. This is an interesting case of a 10-year-old boy on ART since 1 year, but with a pattern like this and a severe, he had no PL in the right eye, and in the left eye he had counting fingers, but note the hemorrhagic pattern which is there. And whenever we see such an hemorrhagic pattern of CMV retinitis, it's always important to check the for any discrasias, hematological abnormalities, and this patient had an hemoglobin of 6. So this patient had failed antiretroviral, the first line, and he was changed to a second line HART and also received blood transfusions, and we've been able to maintain his vision to counting fingers 2 meters in the left eye. What we are seeing these days is in immunocompetent individuals or non-HIV individuals, but they have some apparent immune deficiency. Either they could have a local immune deficiency, like this was a diabetic who had just had an injection tricot, and you see this kind of retinitis, or they would be on immunosuppressive drugs like azathioprine for some other condition, and they develop CMV retinitis like this. What is important in these cases are very refractory to treatment, and they require longer periods of injection. So what a normal HIV patient would take to respond, these patients take longer, and this patient nearly required about 14 injections of ganciclovir. What is important is these cases progress, they have some kind of a vasculopathy and ischemia, and they develop new vascularization. So this is important to watch in these patients. So there are some known complications with CMV-related retinitis. You can have a retinal detachments. But what I would like to highlight most is the drug-induced extravasation. This is something which we tend to ignore. Now, acyclovir and ganciclovir are very dangerous drugs if they get into the subcutaneous area, and they cause bleb-like lesions. Actually, this is a patient with acyclovir. I didn't have the patient with ganciclovir, but they have similar pH. So it is very, very important when you give intravenous injections in these patients, they need hospital admission because they can even go in for necrosis and even amputation of the limb. So other important investigations are, which we need to keep in mind are bone marrow suppression and impaired renal function when these patients are on drugs. So this is just a capsule for taking a particular entity which is CMV-related uveitis and highlighting major clinical features and what are the things which we need to look for in these patients. Thank you so much.
I just like to highlight one point. If you see a anterior uveitis with raised IOP, it's important to look at the fundus. Particularly, you may miss acute retinal necrosis, which can be in the periphery, because that one of the presentation of acute retinal necrosis is the KPs with the raised intraocular pressure.
I think the most important point for viral uveitis will be always look for the intraocular pressures. And if they are very high, we always need to rule out a viral etiology at the time of activity.
And also, it's very important to look in the periphery. Sometimes, you know, just KPs, disc edema, you don't look at the periphery. We do have one or two patients diagnosed and being managed as optic neuritis, but they had small lesions of RN in the periphery, which were kind of ignored. So it's always important to fully dilate and look with indirect, not on slit lamp. Any questions on viral anterior viral uveitis? Kumar? Can we have the mic, please?
Ideally, it is always better to know what, because the drugs will change a little. And even the prognosis, because many times the CMV-related uveitis takes time. It comes back again and again. So it's always better to know the load, what is there. So when you're planning. So if you have access to PCR, I think that would be a good thing to rule out. Certain diagnostic criteria, like for example, a zoster, if they have had a history of zoster or there's a typical sectoral iris atrophy, then we would not do a TAP. But in conditions like these, I would prefer to do a TAP.
If you have got a real-time PCR facility, you can see that the viral copy is going down or getting absent with the resolution of the inflammation.
We do have quite a few times, but many times when the pressures are so high like these, invariably they come out as CMV subsequently. So may not be in the initial tap you would have picked up, but definitely over, say, 3 or 4, once the recurrences start increasing and the cellular load goes up in the aqueous, the chances that you can pick it up are on the higher side. So we do have cases where we've done a tap and nothing has come out, and those are the cases which we watch. And if they develop frequent recurrences or they become refractory to treatment, then we re-tap them again, and usually it comes out positive. But what is important is we are checking for only three viruses. There are many other viruses which could be causing that, which we do not know. And these are the ones which are treatable, in the sense they have some medications available. So if it's an RNA virus, probably like the rubella, we do not have any treatment for that as of now. So in that scenario, of course, yes. We do have a lot of patients with Fuchs with very high IOPs have turned out negative even after multiple taps. Yeah, so the usual, normally when we time the tap is when the pressures are very high. No, because the 30 gauge is controlled, so you usually do not have.
Again, avoid if the IOP is too high. You don't want sudden decompression.
If it is about 60 and on, basically it does help in the sense it gets the IOP low at that point of time, but we do a controlled tapping at that, maybe a passive flow. Like how we normally do for the endoffs, where you take a passive thing so that it doesn't drop too low. But it is generally.
The idea is that you would, at the time it is 60, you can
yeah.
And then you can do it.
Yeah. The idea is that when you do it. No, the idea is not to do it. The idea is to get a bit into the reasonable range before you go in.
Yeah. Usually the control, the passive way, I think if it is too high, then we could do the passive way of collection of the aqueous.
We will do next.
Okay, thank you, Kalpana.
Thank you.
We go on to Dr. Shishir Narayan about toxoplasma retinitis.
Good morning, friends, and very happy 14th February. Can I have the presentation?
Okay. You remember?
Yeah, I still remember after so many years of.
We were so preoccupied trying to reach here at 8 o'clock.
Okay, so we all in this hall know toxoplasmosis and the typical way it presents. But then there are certain things we can always share, and I'll share some of the things that I do in my practice. So, you know, here is a very typical case of reactivation of toxoplasmosis at the edge of a pigmented scar, and it is showing a hypoautofluorescence because the entire lesion is inflamed. And here you see that the angiogram shows you the features of a scar as well as a choroiditis, as well as a retinitis. And this is sometimes helpful because when you have an atypical case of toxoplasmosis, that's when these features help you make a diagnosis. So you have a slowly increasing leakage from the periphery of the active lesion while there is a gradual staining of the area of the scar that is the previous pigmented spot. While the ICG and will show a persistent hyposinescence because of the inflammation of the lower vessels. Now you see here that the same patient, which I've shown you the magnified view, and that's what Vishali just said, who's coming here?
Excuse me. The security wala message.
So same point that Dr. Vishali was saying, that I've done the angiogram and then I put up the patient on a wide field and you see a peripheral lesion. So if you miss out that peripheral lesion and you're only treating the central lesion, then you will actually miss out. And if you look carefully, there is an element of small retinal vasculitis also along the path. So you can pick up the entire picture when you do the ultra wide field. It's not moving further. Okay. So that's why when there is an atypical acute retinal necrosis, then the thing is you are looking at a picture when acute retinal necrosis as well as toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis becomes a differential diagnosis. So this is one of the papers which has 16 patients who are immunodeficient, and you can have an ARN-like picture not only with viral disease but also with toxoplasmosis, syphilis, aspergillosis, Behçet's disease, intraocular lymphoma. They all form a differential diagnosis for an acute ARN-like thing. So that's how I'm saying here. You have one patient here which is an acute retinal necrosis on one side, and you have an atypical toxoplasmosis on the other side. And see, now here the angiogram is helping you. There, the pattern of angiography leak is different in the two lesions. So here you have an ultra-wide field, you have an area of block fluorescence where there is pigmentation, and there is a leakage where there is an active retinitis, and this is helping you to differentiate the two conditions. So this is a very typical severe vitritis, headlight in the fog. But what is important to draw your attention here is that the severe vitritis then leads to a PVD very soon. So here is a vice ring in one eye, the fellow eye does not have anything. So this vitreous disturbance has actually occurred because of the toxoplasmosis retinitis, and there were two retinal breaks in the periphery created by this. And you see here, this is an active lesion, and when it is healed, it has led to a vice ring. You can see here, if you couldn't see it in that, that the vice ring has formed. So I started to study the overlying features of vitreous. So here is a patient which has got a peripheral lesion, and if you do an OCT through that area, you see a very shallow PVD and vitreous cells, and that has been a feature, and you see a retinitis underneath, and that has helped me to differentiate. Here's another case with similar thing. You start seeing a very small PVD because of the severe vitritis that is there, and the area that is shown here is because of the adhesion, because of the toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis here itself. I could only find one review, one report in literature of PVD in being mentioned as a feature of toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis. And here is a published paper which shows a diagnostic approach to ocular toxoplasmosis. They have shown the OCT, but their OCT is also showing a PVD, localized PVD over the retinitis, but it has not been reported or highlighted. So that's something new that I wanted to share. Another thing is that you can have retinal vasculitis, you can have very severe inflammation which is hidden, like what Dr. Vishali was saying. So you have this, and you do, and you see a huge pars plana membrane which is overlying the periphery in a patient of toxoplasmosis. So, you know, you have to look at the periphery. The secondary changes can occur. I showed you the PVD. There can be a CNVN formation. There can be a new vascularization which is intraretinal. So these are the things that can happen. And then, because this is a retinochoroiditis, it is in the retinal layers, so the retinal vasculitis occurs. And here you can see a branch retinal artery or a combined occlusion occurring. There is a pigmented patch, there is an activity at the edge of the patch, and there is a retinal vasculitis with a vascular block. So various things that can happen is scar formation, vascular occlusion, NVE, CNVM, and you can have PVD. Something Dr. JB likes to always highlight is that a positive IgG is helpful in negative IgG does excludes a diagnosis of toxoplasmosis, while a positive IgG does not help you in making a definitive diagnosis. A quick word about the treatment. So we all know the conventional treatment, that there is there are various strains of toxoplasmosis, and the worst ones are in South America, where there's more work from there, and they believe that you can give twice a week or once in 3 days trimethoprim sulfur methoxazole combination, and that keeps the toxoplasmosis from recurring. Another thing is intravitreal injection of clindamycin, which is available in two doses, and Since the half-life is 5 days, you can give it in combination with dexamethasone. But the thing to remember is that never to give it along with, this is a case that was given to me by Ale, which in a pregnant lady, you want to make sure that it is IgM negative and IgG positive so that the pregnancy can continue. Otherwise, it means that's a fresh infection. And once you have the, you can give an intravitreal injection. Is the time up?
Yes.
Then I'll just find out.
So Reema,
so just two cases of fulminant toxoplasmosis have been reported by an enthusiastic group which give intravitreal trimethoprim alone acetate, and this was published in IJO. And as Dr. Kalpana also said, that CMV can occur after tricot. You can have fulminant toxoplasmic endophthalmitis after this. So if your patient is worsening on steroids alone, please think about toxoplasmosis as a differential diagnosis. And because it is a congenital infection, you can have a combination. You can have a toxocara and a toxoplasma in the same patient. This patient comes from Russia, and he actually is HLA-B27 positive as well. So he has not been given adalimumab because there's a double infection in this patient. Thank you very much for your patience.
I just want to make one point. We never think about, very rarely think about toxoplasmosis if we present with the anterior uveitis, particularly granulomatous anterior uveitis. I've got a patient who has got multiple corneal keratic precipitates studied over all over the cornea. I was not able to see the back part of the eye. I was did an anterior chamber tap. PCR came as positive for microactin tuberculosis. I did not do the ELISA for the toxoplasma. But when the inflammation subsided, I could see that necrotizing retinochoroiditis. And I was so confused. I sent the photo to Professor Amod Gupta. He said that I agree with you that it's a toxoplasma lesion. And we did ELISA for the toxoplasma. It came positive. It responded to the clindamycin and prednisolone. So don't think that toxoplasma cannot occur in as present as the anterior uveitis. We should always keep in mind that it could be a possibility of toxoplasma infection back part of the eye.
Sir, how effective is PCR as a diagnostic tool for an ocular specimen?
The toxoplasma, the PCR doesn't work very well because there are several strains of toxoplasma is there, and the primers are for particular few strains. Not all the strains is for toxoplasma is available. So multiplex PCR might be helpful.
I think we are running behind the schedule, so we move on to Dr. Reema Bansal. And Anirudh, please prepare your case, you know.
I can present from here. Very good morning to all of you. So, as we know, tubercular anterior uveitis in the, can present as granulomatous most commonly, and we can have varied manifestations either in the form of KPs or iris nodules. Coming to the posterior segment manifestations, the commonest are retinal vasculitis, serpiginous lichoroiditis, choroidal granuloma, but the spectrum is wide and we can have any manifestation, but these are by far the most common associations. Now, from our experience of these signs being quite predictive of ocular TB, and their response and the response to ATT in terms of a very favorable outcome tells us that we treat these patients with these clinical signs successfully with ATT. And now that we have reports coming up from COTS, it's a very good diagnosis to make because we have effective treatment available. So I'll show you some clinical examples of very classic presentations. You see this patient presenting with decreased vision in the left eye. The right eye is normal here. You have active lesions of serpiginous lichoroiditis in the left eye, quite prominent on the autofluorescence. The Montux at this visit was normal. However, since the lesions were quite active and involving the fovea, we actually did not wait for the CT chest report and started oral steroids. We expected the patient to come back with the report in a week, but the patient turned up a month later on steroids alone. You can see the lesions in the left eye are responding very well, as also on the autofluorescence, and still at this time he did not have the CT chest report with us. We called the patient next week, but however the patient was lost to follow-up and probably he just took steroids intermittently. He turns up 3 years later, and now that you see his fellow eye, which is the right eye, which is not involved earlier, now shows extensive scarring suggesting that he did develop this disease in the right eye as well during these 3 years. And in addition to that, the previous scar of the left eye has now active lesions elsewhere in the left eye. So he has bilateral serpiginous lichenoiditis after 3 years. At this time, when he got the CT chest report, CT scan done, there was very clear-cut evidence of TB infection in the form of tree and bud appearance with bilateral mediastinal lymphadenopathy. And the etiology was obviously suggestive of tuberculosis. The bronchoalveolar lavage tested positive on GeneXpert. So we treated him, this according to our recent classification of ocular TB. This patient fitted into the possible intraocular TB, having one clinical sign quite suggestive of TB and evidence of CT chest having TB, although he did not have a positive Montauk. So 1 and 4 criteria suggest it was a possible intraocular TB. We treated him successfully this time with steroids and anti-TB therapy, and this is the follow-up at 2 years with bilateral healed lesions. Second case, again, a very classical presentation of ocular TB, a choroidal granuloma. These granulomas are very typical in the form of they're usually solitary, they're usually in the posterior pole, they're usually accompanied by an exudative response, unlike the granulomas of sarcoid or any other disease. And it's a large granuloma, quite many times it's vascular. So the combined FFA and ICG showed a hypolesion on fluorescein, followed by hypofluorescence, which maintained hyposinescence in both the frames of ICG. The OCT showed there was a large choroidal granuloma pushing the entire choroid and retina up with subretinal fluid and fibrin. So this was a classical representation of tubercular choroidal granuloma. We treated this patient with oral steroids, anti-TB therapy, and intravitreal anti-VEGF agents as adjunct, because they're known to be very useful in these kind of pathologies. So this is the response at 1 week. You can see the granuloma shrinking in size, the exudation going down, even as seen on the OCT. This is at 1 week. The top one is the baseline, the bottom at 1 week, and now the bottom at 3 weeks. Almost complete resolution of the fluid and the granuloma. So this is the follow-up at 1 year with scarring, which subsequently goes on increasing over a period of time. So this is again a successful response of choroidal granuloma to steroids, anti-TB therapy, and intraventral anti-VEGF agents. So it's not always a very active disease that we are dealing with. Sometimes we are dealing with these kind of patients, and we just pay our attention to these stormy lesions of serpiginous lichenoiditis and granuloma and vasculitis. I brought this case up to highlight few things. Now, the left eye patient presents with vitreous hemorrhage, very obvious, decreased vision. So our prompt step is to take up this patient for vitrectomy. However, we somehow, for reason unknown, we try to do angiogram in this patient, and the left eye, as expected, showed a lot of neovascularization on the disc, elsewhere in the periphery, large neovascular fronts, vitreous hemorrhage and subhyaloid hemorrhage. The right eye, as expected, the posterior pole was normal, fair enough, because the clinical examination did not show anything. But the upper temporal periphery showed a large NVE. Similarly, nasal periphery and upper nasal periphery. So although there were no lesions of active vasculitis, we did investigate this patient, had a borderline positive Montauk's, and CT chest was normal. Not that we wanted to give anti-TB therapy, we just wanted to know the association with TB vasculitis. So we took up this patient for vitrectomy in the left eye, and this is the follow-up following vitrectomy, parse plan of vitrectomy with endolaser photocoagulation in the left eye. We also did scatter laser photocoagulation in the right eye, which otherwise would have been missed if we had not done the angiogram. And fortunately, at 5 years, the patient is following up with us. This is the final outcome. Both eyes lasered very well. And we just thought of repeating the angiogram at 5 years. This was the baseline in the left eye. And this is the repeat angiogram at 5 years with complete scatter laser photocoagulation, no leakage. Similarly, in the right eye, all the NVs have resolved and nicely lasered eye. So another challenge is the paradoxical worsening in serpiginous lichenoiditis. Just one example, this was a macular lesion that presented active. So it was a fovea threatening lesion. We started oral steroids with anti-TB therapy. There was TST positive. However, at 5 weeks, there was paradoxical worsening, and which responded very well to the intravitreal Ozurdex, which is again a useful adjunct in these patients. So key points in managing TB uveitis is you have to keep these ocular signs which are predictive of ocular TB in mind, along with the testing of tuberculin skin test and CT chest. Ophthalmic imaging should be performed relevant to the clinical features and the phenotype, and ensure patient's compliance for follow-up and ATT. Ozodex and anti-VEGF injections are quite valuable intravitreal adjuncts. Thank you very much.
One of the other presentation of tubercular uveitis could be a subretinal abscess, and that can occur in the immunocompetent as well as the immunocompromised patients. We have seen in the AIDS patients also subretinal abscess. Other differential diagnosis could be nocardia, but in our country the tuberculosis should be kept in mind.
No, many times we don't have active extraocular TB in these patients. So if we don't have, and we have a positive Montux test and plus a active clinical lesion in the eye, so we do treat these patients with anti-TB therapy.
Question he's asking is that normally now we have to report all TB patients. So is the ophthalmologist reporting, or you report through the pulmonologist and you ask them a consult?
Report what?
You have to, every TB patient,
yes,
is now reported.
We ask a patient to report to the DOT center in our institute.
We have to send the report to every patient.
Yes.
And we are not having any documentary evidence that. Once you have the active inflammation in the eye, that itself is an active evidence that there is an extra pulmonary TB. You can send it to DOTs. They will not refuse the treatment and ask them to register. Thank you, Rima.
I'd like to invite Dr. Anirudh to speak on intermittent uveitis.
Thank you very much. Very good morning. Thank you for this kind invitation. I'll be speaking on intermediate uveitis and a few common cases and presentations. We all know that intermediate uveitis consists of predominantly an anterior vitreous inflammation with spillover in the anterior chamber. And you also have certain hallmark characteristics such as snowballs and snow banking in the periphery, peripheral retinal vasculitis, and cystoid macular edema. Often you can also find additional features which could be presence of some retinal vasoproliferative tumor like growth in the retina or peripheral retinal neovascularization in these patients. You may also have peripheral retinoschisis, which is also an indicator of active inflammation. And sometimes the inflammation may be accompanied by optic nerve head inflammation as well. So intermediate uveitis, I think, is one of the most complicated diagnoses because there could be a number of entities that could be associated with this condition. And let's see this case number one here. This is a young girl with intermediate uveitis. And you can see that your slit lamp examination with a 90 diopter lens can very easily show you presence of these large snowballs in the inferior periphery. And you can see clinically these patients may have evidence of peripheral retinal vasculitis. And if you investigate these patients for tuberculosis, these patients may have necrotic or even a large sized induration from a Montu test, and they may have additional testing done which may reveal evidence of extrapulmonary TB. Fluorescein angiography typically shows you presence of some haze because of vitritis. These patients may have cystoid macular edema, which is an important cause of vision loss in intermediate uveitis. And often these patients will have active vascular inflammation. Now this patient actually had a nodule in the breast, and she was given a diagnosis of masquerade syndrome before she presented to us. So the examination did reveal a lobulated nodule, and she was diagnosed with a masquerade and referred to a higher center. So the question therefore is the Montu testing enough to diagnose TB? And sometimes you may require extensive systemic evaluation in these patients. And so she did undergo ultrasound guided biopsy, which showed just a benign duct adenosis. But whereas a biopsy of axillary lymph node did show epithelioid cells, granulomas, Langhans giant cells, and in fact, this patient also had Zeal-Nelson positive from peripheral lymph node, confirming the diagnosis of tuberculosis. So these patients may require an extensive systemic workup to be able to diagnose this with reasonable certainty. The COT study actually showed that intermediate uveitis with tuberculosis is seen in 15%, And if you combine intermediate and pan uveitis, which are, I think, one of the most difficult diagnoses, this is seen in nearly 50% patients. Now, intermediate uveitis may be associated with systemic pathologies, such as this patient who had a long history. 2007, she was diagnosed with iritis. 2010, she was diagnosed with post-infectious optic neuritis, treated with IV steroids, and MRI had some lesions in the white matter which were inconclusive. And in 2013, she received a diagnosis of bilateral Fuchs uveitis. Her problem is floaters in both the eyes at the moment in 2018, and she is seeing 6/6 from both the eyes. There's no scotoma, no metamorphopsia. If you look at the clinical picture, there is 1+ vitreous haze, and the fluorescein angiography does not essentially show you much leakage in the right eye. And even in the left eye, you have some vitreous haze, vitritis, and you have essentially not much of a vascular inflammation or a cystoid macular edema in this patient. Also, this patient had anterior chamber inflammation with granulomatous KPs, cells, and iris nodules. So these are the serial MRIs of this patient, and you can see that there are certain periventricular white matter lesions. I can show you here with the cursor here. These are the periventricular white matter lesions which have increased over the period of 3 years. And this patient was seen by the neurologist who has diagnosed this patient with multiple sclerosis. And the uveitis associated with multiple sclerosis is not very common. It's seen in 1%. But you can have patients of uveitis with who have a preceded diagnosis of MS. That's a more common presentation. If you have uveitis with multiple sclerosis, it would be usually an intermediate uveitis in 85% patients. But you may have other features such as anterior granulomatous uveitis, which would be certain, you know, it may be a little unusual to have this in multiple sclerosis. Again, intermediate uveitis could be could represent an underlying sinister pathology, like this 67-year-old female who has 2-month history of blurriness and some tingling in the arms and tremors. Now, she is the mother of a neurologist who essentially, you know, was told us that this, my mother is normal. She does not have any neurological disease. And if you see her clinically, she has vitritis. There is vitreous haze. There is no macular edema, but you have these very small RPE-like bumps here that you can see in the macular scan. And 2 months later, this patient presents with weakness, fatigue, aphasia, and gait disturbance. And there is a patchy, ill-defined, altered signal area in the multiple brain lesions. The PET did not have any other evidence of hypermetabolism, and the CSF and diagnostic vitrectomy gave us the diagnosis of a B-cell lymphoma in this patient. And this patient then received systemic chemotherapy, and this is the clinical picture after intravitreal methotrexate. So finally, the most important etiology of intermediate uveitis that we should consider once you have ruled out all the other pathologies is pars planitis, which is an entity which requires immunosuppression in case the inflammation is persistent or if you have persistent macular edema. Some of the other causes of non-infectious uveitis which presents as intermediate could be sarcoid, Blau syndrome, which we are nowadays seeing very commonly in children. It's like a pediatric sarcoid. Also, TINU and Sjogren syndrome may be the other causes of intermediate uveitis. Very briefly, the algorithm of intermediate uveitis would be to rule out infectious and systemic conditions that we have just discussed. And if you deem that there is inflammation which requires therapy, you can go ahead with the Kaplan approach. But now with the evidence of efficacy and safety of intravitreal steroids, we are more and more using intravitreal dexamethasone implants to treat these patients. If you have unilateral disease, you can also go ahead with systemic steroids if you have a bilateral disease. The use of periocular steroids is now reducing. And some of the other therapies that you can use is beyond systemic steroids would be immunosuppression or biologics. And pars plana vitrectomy would be indicated only in very few cases who do not respond to therapy or where you would require to do a therapeutic sort of clearing of the vitreous to relieve either the traction or an opaque vitreous, or if you have complications such as retinal detachment. Thank you very much. And just this slide on the upcoming meeting. Rishi, please mark your dates for 26 and 27 September. It's a retinal imaging conference that we're holding in Mussoorie. So please try to block your calendar and if you can make it. Thank you.
I just want to highlight one point. In case of intermediate uveitis, if you don't see sharp foveal reflex, don't hesitate to do an OCT, because the treatment strategy is to just reduce the vision or salvage the vision by taking step to cystoid macular edema, which might be missed by cursory examination.
Thank you, Dr. Anirudh. We'll have Dr. Manisha speaking on syphilitic uveitis. Dr. Manisha, please.
My presentation. So good morning, everyone. And syphilitic uveitis is something which was initially very rare in our country, but now apparently it's on the rise. And that is why it is an entity which we all need to recognize very timely in our clinics. This was my initial experience of managing one patient who presented to my clinic. And not for being, aware so much about syphilitic uveitis, but fortunately I had attended a uveitis conference and that's where a case was presented. And probably that is something which really helped me to recognize this particular case. So she was a 38-year-old unmarried female patient who presented with pain, redness, blurring of vision in the left eye for the last 5 days. And she also complained of photophobia and floaters in the left eye. She had a history of hypothyroidism, nausea and vomiting associated with stomachache, history of recurrent ulcerations over the breasts and hair loss. However, there was no history of exposure. Now, in our cultural background, if we have an unmarried female, we are a little reluctant to ask beyond this. And that's why we were quite sure that we were not dealing with something like a sexually transmitted disease. She was already on treatment for anemia, esophageal reflux, and also for hypothyroidism. So when we examined, her right eye had a best corrected visual acuity of 66N6, while the left eye, the vision was as low as hand movements close to face, with some element of anterior uveitis. So this is how the right eye appeared, though she had a vision of 6-6. You had this typical posterior plecoid retinochoroiditis in the right eye, while in the left eye you had a hyperemic optic nerve head with these typical intraretinal precipitates. Now this is something which we really need to recognize, and a patch of retinochoroiditis in the left eye. So she was advised investigations but was lost to follow-up for 3 weeks and was investigated elsewhere. And you see these are the whole gamut of investigations that she underwent at some other place which were quite irrelevant. So these are the other investigations, but what was significant was that we had a Mantoux which was zero and the rest were all very indefinitive or very irrelevant investigations. So she was diagnosed elsewhere as viral retinitis, because you see over here all these came out to be positive, and that's where probably the other clinician felt they were dealing with a viral retinitis in this patient. And she was started on a tablet valacyclovir 1 gram TDS with oral steroids. So she presented again after 1 month to us, because now she started losing vision in the right eye for the last 2 days, and she had ocular pain in both the eyes. And the initial presentation with a 6-6 vision in the right eye, she had dropped down to 636N24 in the right eye as well now when she presented again to our clinic. So she had this ground glass retinochoroiditis in the right eye, and you see in the left eye the lesions had further progressed and they were appearing to be more fulminant. This is how she appeared on the autofluorescence. And when we did a fundus fluorescein angiography, what you see is this leading edge, what was there beyond the edges of the active retinochoroiditis, which could be clinically recognized. There was also an element of vasculitis, which was very much prevalent in both the eyes. This is how the left eye was, where you had a hot disk, you had an element of vasculitis, and again you had a patchy hyperfluorescence, which was corresponding to the retinochoroiditis patch. Now on the OCT, what you can very classically see are these intraretinal precipitates, which one needs to recognize and keep in mind when you are dealing with a patient of syphilis. So when we investigated her further, her HIV-1 was reactive, her CD4 counts were low, and her VDRL was reactive. So we went ahead and did a TPHA also, and which came out rightly to be positive, which confirmed the diagnosis that we were dealing with a syphilitic uveitis. So she was started on a heart therapy for HIV, and she was put on all these medications by the treating physician. She was also put on an injection of benzathine penicillin, 2.4 million international units intramuscular weekly for 3 weeks. Prednisolone acetate eye drops were continued for the anterior uveitis she was having, and oral valacyclovir and steroids were stopped at this stage. Now, what is important for all of us to remember is that we have to rule out neurosyphilis in such patients. So a CSF analysis was done, and rightly so, a 2 ml of clear fluid was taken. Now, an important learning for all of us is that when you are doing a CSF analysis, TPHA is something which comes out negative when you are analyzing the CSF, and what is confirmatory is the VDRL. So VDRL was positive in the CSF analysis that was done. The patient was also put on a second-line antibiotic along with the ongoing management. So after 3 weeks of treatment, a CSF sampling was again done, which now came out to be negative for VDRL, and her CD4 count started now going up. So after 2 weeks of treatment, you see there was a drastic improvement and a resolution of all her lesions in the right eye. However, the vitreous haze was quite bad in the left eye. So follow-up at 6 weeks, she had regained a vision to 618 N6 in the right eye. However, in the left eye, we were unable to salvage her vision, which dropped down to finger countings at 1.5 meters. And this probably was because of the extensive sclerosing of the vessels, which had already set in the left eye. Follow-up at 6 months, she improved marginally to 612 parts and N6 in the right eye. However, the left eye could not be, it could not recover the vision. OCT, of course, there was a resolution of all the intraretinal precipitates that we had seen initially. And we published this case as syphilitic uveitis misdiagnosed as viral retinitis, a misleading history. And why I highlighted this in the case report, that the entire thing was missed out because the patient said that she was unmarried, and that's why I ruled out a syphilis in the initial presentation. So this is something we need to keep in mind. So syphilis, it's a sexually transmitted infection caused by Treponema pallidum, and it may also be transmitted from mother to baby during pregnancy or at birth, resulting in congenital syphilis. It causes serious long-term problems such as arthritis, brain damage, and blindness. So my take-home pearls from this particular case is that the history of exposure is extremely important, and we might be required to invest a little more extra time to get this history out. TPHA, again, is important for diagnosis and confirms our diagnosis of syphilis. We must check the immune status of our patient when we are suspecting a syphilitic infection. Neurosyphilis has to be ruled out in such patients, and VDRL is something which is important to help us monitor neurosyphilis management. Thank you so much.
Just like to highlight one point is the syphilis, when occurs in the eye, other opportunistic infections, the CD4 count is relatively higher side. Other opportunistic infection you don't see. And if you see the subretinal precipitates, this kind of which has shown, is very diagnostic of syphilitic infection in the eye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha. We'll have the last talk from Dr. Padma Malmani on endogenous endophthalmitis.
Respected chairpersons and dear friends, very good morning to all of you. Endogenous endophthalmitis is defined as an intraocular infection resulting from hematogenous microbial spread. It's extremely rare in LT population. It's commonly seen in chronically ill patients with uncontrolled diabetes or a chronic renal failure, immunocompromised states. Intravenous drug abuses and indwelling catheters are a predisposition for the development of endogenous endophthalmitis. So what are the clinical symptoms? The patient presents with pain, diminished vision, and redness. Coming to the signs, anterior segment is characterized by the circumciliary congestion, hypopyon with AC reaction. In the posterior segment, they can have vitritis, retinal vasculitis, retinal hemorrhages, or retinal exudates. Pigmented hypopyon is classically described in association with iris necrosis and hole secondary to Listeria monocytogen infection. Slides are moving forward. Endogenous endophthalmitis is a true ophthalmic emergency. Diagnosis, we make it based on the clinical judgment. We need to start the treatment before the investigational reports available to us. We do the specimens for the culture, the smear, molecular diagnostic test, and empirically we start the patient on antimicrobial therapy. In addition to that, we also have to thoroughly investigate the patient for systemic evaluation, which gives us a clue in many times. blood counts to check for the leukocytosis and other focus of infection. Depending on that, we ordered the investigations. In the eye, anterior chamber tap or the vitreous tap can be done and subjected for various microbiological testings. First, we have to find out where the focus of infection is. Suppose if the respiratory tract infection, then we take the sputum or the throat swab. If the patient has burning micturition, then urine evaluation gives us a clue. Gastroenteritis for the stool evaluation. If the patient has meningism, then CSF. If the patient has focus of infection or abscess anywhere in the body, the aspirate from the abscess gives us a clue. We need to manage them with antimicrobial. Depending upon the etiology, it could be in the form of topical, systemic, the local therapy. Cycloprilogics helps to relieve the pain. Systemic NSAIDs also helps to bring down the inflammation. The steroids we use in the form of topical or intravitreal as a supplementary one. If the patients are refractory to medical management, we subject them for Passmann and vitrectomy, both for the diagnosis and also the therapeutic point of view from the eye inflammation. Here is a 45-year-old male presented with pain and redness in the right eye. He gave history of lithotripsy for the DJ stent was put for the ureteric calculus. When the patient developed uveitis, it was treated with systemic steroids by the local ophthalmologist elsewhere. When the patient presented with worsening of the symptoms, here we could see the AC reaction with fibrinous exudates, and we can see the vitreous exudates, the ball-like appearance, what classically we see it in case of candidial infection. The simple routine microscopy shows the presence of yeast cells. SDA media confirms the presence of candida growth, and this patient was treated with systemic intravitreal antifungal therapy. The next case is a 21-year-old female, healthy female, presented with a decreased vision since few hours. She had gastroenteritis. She had a wedding coming up in 1 week. When she went for a shopping locally in a native place, she had a panipuri. Subsequently, she developed gastroenteritis. The over-enthusiastic parents, they want her to get better. They insisted and they admitted and they gave her IV fluids in a rural setup with antimicrobial therapy. Here the patient presents with decrease in vision, the fibrinous exudates with, you can see the granulomatous AP, it's there in bilateral, organized, associated with posterior segment inflammation. The clinical diagnosis of bilateral panuveitis, endogenous endof was suspected, and we ordered the investigations. The urine showed increased pus cells, empirically started on antibiotic, however the urine culture and sensitivity came negative. AC tap showed KOH fungal filaments was positive. PCR for the panfungal genome was also positive. The patient was treated with intravitreal antibiotic and antifungal agents. The key was the patient was insisting that she should not have any redness in the eye when they take the photograph during a video recording during the wedding. Here we are struggling with the vision, they are more bothered about the cosmetic one. So finally, we could manage the patient with intravenous, topical, as well as the intravitreal antifungal therapy with low dose of steroids. Here we could see the complete resolution of inflammation in this case. Pediatric endogenous endof we see, but most often we recognize at a later date. Here is a 24-year-old male child, had abscess in the hand, subsequently developed decrease in vision. AC aspirate showed gram-negative bacilli. In spite of aggressive treatment with topical, intravitreal and systemic, we could not save the eye. Not only save the eye, the child developed obstructive hydrocephalus, finally have to undergo for the VP shunt, did not recover, we lost the child. So many times it's associated with systemic infections as well that has to be treated aggressively. The next case is a 27-year-old female presented with diminution of vision with pain and redness in the right eye since 3 days. She gave history of fever. She was hospitalized and treated with intravenous antibiotic and IV fluids. Visceral visual acuity was counting finger 3 meter in the right eye. Patient had AC reaction with hypopyon. The left eye is normal. This is a fundus picture where we could see the yellowish necrotic kind of retina in the posterior pole. The OCD shows hyperreflectivity after shadowing. On investigations, the patient had increased pus cells in the urine. Again, urine culture was negative. AC tap came positive for HSV1 and eubacterial genome came positive. HSV1 also confirmed by RT-PCR showed significant copies. The patient was treated with oral antibiotic, antiviral,
Here again, the patient, immunocompetent young girl, rural setup, IV infusion. The fungal also was taught in the differential diagnosis. So empirically, I started the patient on antifungal as well. Patient received intravitreal vancomycin and ganciclovir in the first day. Subsequently, there was a worsening of inflammations in the anterior segment. Patient has to undergo surgery, partial vitrectomy with the silicone oil infusion. It showed a fungal filaments with significant RT-PCR for HSV-1 from the vitreous. Here the bacteria came negative. SDA showing the aspergillus growth. So this particular patient was treated with triple therapy of antibiotic, antiviral, antifungal, and low dose of oral steroids was added. This is at the follow-up where we could see the resolved retinitis following the retinochoroidal scar. So endogenous endophthalmitis due to mixed infarction is a clinical challenge not only for the diagnosis and also managing. It can occur in immunocompetent young individuals. Endogenous endophthalmitis is a severe complication of a systemic disease. Early diagnosis is essential and sudden intervention is required to save patient's sight and to treat the systemic infection. Initially, we start the patient on empirical therapy with intravitreal vanco and cefta for a bacterial endogenous endophthalmitis and for oreganazole in a case of fungal endophthalmitis. Corticosteroid use is controversial, but it can be given under cover of appropriate antimicrobial therapy to control the inflammation. To conclude, endogenous endophthalmitis, though a dreaded complication of a systemic infection, can be managed appropriately with appropriate antimicrobial therapy. Early recognition and aggressive therapy is important not only to save the vision but also to control the systemic infection in these cases. Thank you for your attention.
Conclude.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was white.
Yes, it was a great task. Intravitreal, like, you know.
Sure, it was.
We have to avoid the vessels and, like, you know.
Yeah, no, she sure. It was white.